Hello students, and welcome to my channel English Made Easy with Nandi. And today I'm again with you all and with a very beautiful, yet another very very beautiful poem of a very famous nature poet, William Butler Yeast, W.B. Yeast popularly known as. And it is from class 9th Beehive NCERT book, and the name of the poem is The Lake Isle of Innisfree. This poem written by the poet is a beautiful depiction of what humans, or we can say what we busy beings, busy people feel about the city life, what we think, and what are the ways which we want to find out, to find solace in our life. That peace is missing from the lives of the people who are living in the cities. They are not at peace. There is no serenity, there is no calmness in their life. People, they are so busy that they don't spare time for themselves to introspect, to actually find out why they have come to this earth, to actually be one with the nature. They have no time to stand and stare at the starry night. They have no time to look at the beautiful landscapes of nature. They even don't have time for their family, for the people around them. And therefore the poet has written a very beautiful poem, keeping the same restorative idea in his mind. He has given this title, this place, The Lake Isle of Innisfree. The title is full of imagery, full of imagination. And this place, Innisfree, is actually in the imagination of the poet, who thought to escape from the chaos and the corruption of the city life, and he wants to go there, to that place. He is wanting through hearts and hearts to go there. So students, let us begin with the explanation of this beautiful poem. I hope you all will like it. So we'll do the explanation line by line. So the first stanza goes like this. I will arise and go now, and go to Innisfree, and a small cabin build there of clay and wattles made. So the poet is wanting to go to the place named Innisfree. He says that I want to go there. Now he says, I will arise and go now. Arise and go now means he is desirous. Through hearts and hearts, he is wanting to go to a place which is far, far away from the problems, from the troubles of this world. Now we come to the second line, and a small cabin built there of clay and wattles made. Now the poet is assuming, is thinking in his mind, he is imagining that I will have a small cabin. Cabin doesn't mean a cabin of four walls. Cabin actually means a very small cottage, or you can say a small house, which is made of clay. As you know, children, that in the villages, when you go towards the village or when you go towards the countryside, you will find houses which are made of clay, which are made of mud, the mud houses, which we call in Hindi, we call them kacha houses, the cottages, the huts, the hutments. So the poet, he is wanting to build a small hut for himself. And one more thing, students, when the poet says, and a small cabin built, maybe the poet is all alone. He is one and only. Maybe because of that, he is saying that I'll build a very small cabin for myself. And in his loneliness, he'll pass his time in Innisfree. So the house will be made of clay and wattles. Wattles means the branches of the tree. Okay, the branches of the tree which are used to make the huts, the cottages in the remote areas, in the interiors, in the countryside. 9 bean rows will I have there. A hive for honeybee. Now again the poet says, now when you have to go and stay somewhere, obviously you need some food to eat, isn't it? So from where will the food come? As the farmers, they grow the crops in the countryside. So in the same way, maybe the poet is thinking that he will grow beans. Beans here means two things. One is the literal meaning, that is beans, a vegetable. And the other can be food grains, or you can say a livelihood for himself. The 9 bean rows means the sufficient food which is required by the poet to lead his life in the village. So he will grow the bean rows over there, and also a hive for the honeybees. This shows that the poet loves to be in village. He is so frustrated, so troubled by the life which he is in the city. And he wants to leave that. And now in the last line of the stanza he says, and live alone in the bee loud glade. And now he says that I will live all alone. I will lead a very contented life. I'll be all alone. I'll be happy. It will be a bliss for me. I will really enjoy my life, my time in the village, or you can say in the countryside. And what kind of a place that would be? Bee loud glade. Bee loud glade means an area which is covered with grass. There are no trees, but a small cottage. Just think of it, students. There is a small beautiful cottage. There is grass, a sheet of grass, you can say, or you can say a blanket of grass around, and honeybees, they are buzzing, the sound of the bees here and there, and solace, peace. One more thing, students. This poem, it is divided, each stanza. So whenever there are four lines in each stanza, so that particular poem is called a quatrain. It is divided into quatrains, means a stanza of four lines. Okay, so now we come to the second stanza. Again, a very beautiful one. The poet says, "And I shall have some peace there, for peace comes dropping slow, dropping from the veils of the morning to where the cricket sings." Now the poet is saying, "And I shall have some peace there." The poet says, when I'll go there to Innisfree, I'll have some peaceful life, some peaceful days of my life. I'll spend over there amidst nature, amidst beauty. And again the poet says, "For peace comes dropping slow." He says, peace will come slowly, because when you have been living in the city, you are used to that type of living. And when all of a sudden you come to the countryside, the life changes. And slowly the life of that countryside gives solace to your heart. You find peace. Why? Because you find time for yourself. You find time to introspect about yourself. So that's why the poet says that peace comes dropping slow. So how does the peace come? It comes dropping slowly. Dropping from the veils of the morning to where the cricket sings. Again the poet says that peace is coming very slowly from the veils of the morning. The poet has very beautifully talked of peace and morning. He has compared it. He says that as morning comes slowly after the darkness of the night, in the same way, the peace will come slowly into my heart and have a place there. I'll be peaceful. I'll be at peace. I'll feel good. I'll feel contented, which is very important, students. You should be satisfied in what you are, what you have. You should not keep running after things, because these desires will not die otherwise. So that's why the poet has said that dropping from the veils of the morning to where the cricket sings. He said, I'll feel good when early in the morning I'll hear the sound of the cricket. And it will add a kind of a melody to the beauty, to the serenity of the morning of the countryside. How nice it would be when the cricket will sing and I'll open my eyes in the morning. And the morning will dawn on me. I'll really be very happy. Again the poet says, there midnight is all a glimmer and noon a purple glow. Now the poet says that night, midnight is all a glimmer. Glimmer means it's very weak, it's very light. And noon a purple glow. So what kind of midnight I'll have in the at the place Innisfree. So the midnight is going to be weak. It is going to be light. And what kind of noon will be there? The noon will be purplish. The noon will be like purple flowers. So a very beautiful imagery by the poet. He has imagined the midnight as a glimmer. Glimmer means a shine which is very weak and light, of the twinkling of the stars at night. The poet, he says again, I will arise and go now, for always night and day. As the poet had said in the very first stanza, I will arise and go now and go to Innisfree. But in that particular stanza, he had shown his dream. His dream was depicted. He had talked of his dream that he wants to go to Innisfree. But here, in the last stanza, it seems as if the poet is coming out of his daydreaming. And the poet is saying, I will arise and go now, for always night and day. I hear the lake water lapping with low sounds by the shore. Now the poet is dreaming in the daytime, and he is imagining that the lake where the place Innisfree is there. At Innisfree there is a lake, and the water of that lake is lapping. Lapping means touching. It is touching with low sounds by the shore. It is touching the shore and it is making very soft sound, not a very loud or a harsh one that we feel in the cities, the honking of the horns, the loud talks of the people, the fighting, chaos, nothing of like that sort, but a soft sound of the water of the lake at Innisfree. While I stand on the roadway or on the pavement gray, I hear it in the deep heart's core. Again, the poet says, rather the poet is thinking of that particular place Innisfree where he dreams to go, where he wants to go one day to get peace at heart, to feel good, just to alienate himself from the troubles of the city life. He says, while I stand on the roadway, means while I'm standing on the road in the city life, in the city, or I'm standing on a pavement. Pavement is that part of the road which is made for the pedestrians to walk on. Okay, so he says, either I stand on the road or I walk on the pavement, means on the roadside, I'm dreaming of that beautiful place, Innisfree. And whether the lake or the noontime or the morning and the singing of the cricket, all these things are reminded again and again. The reminiscence of all those things are there in my mind. And I would love to be at that place. I would love to stay there for long, away from the city life, away from the frustration of my life in the city. So this was all about the poem, what William Butler East wanted to say. Through the poem, the lake Isle of Innisfree. A beautiful imaginary title with a beautiful imagination of the village life, or you can say the countryside life. Before I give you the central idea, let us recall the figure of speeches which I used. So in the first stanza, we have a phrase, I will arise and go now. And again, it has been repeated in the last stanza, in the very first line, I will arise and go now. So here we have the literary device called repetition. Now, we come to the last line of the second stanza. It is there midnight's all a glimmer and noon a purple glow. Again in this line we have imagery. The poet has imagined a beautiful noontime and a beautiful midnight. So the figure of speech here is imagery. Now coming down to the last stanza, the second line, the poet says, I hear the lake water lapping with low sounds by the shore. So sounds by the shore, we have alliteration here. The repetition of the consonant S in sound and in shore. Basically, students, the theme which the poet has taken, it is actually a differentiation. The poet is differentiating between the countryside, or you can say the nature, and the civilization, means the humans, the concrete cities which the humans have made, and the nature of the nature god. He has beautifully differentiated between both of them, what the nature is and what the human civilization is. And he has talked about a close contact of humans with the nature. The poet says that nature is always blissful. Nature is always beautiful and always giving, provided that we have time to be one with nature. So this was the central idea behind this poem. I am remembered of a beautiful line of one of the poets, one of the very famous poets. What is this life if full of care? We have no time to stand and stare. So this can also be related with what the poet here in this poem is wanting to tell. He's saying that find some time for yourself. Be one with the nature. And definitely all your frustration will go. It will give peace to the frustrated souls. You'll feel good. You'll feel elated. The serenity of the nature will make you feel better, better at heart. So this was all about the poem, The Lake Isle of Innisfree by William Butler East. So children, now we come to the central idea. What is the poet wanting the reader to know? The poet says that we need peace in life. The poet says, we need to preserve the nature. The poet also says, he is also talking about the inner drive for harmony. Somewhere our soul is wanting harmony. And where do we get that? Do we get that in the hustle bustle of the city life? No. We will get solace. We will get peace when we escape from the cities towards the nature, amidst nature. That is the place where we'll feel better. The poet also wants to tell us that the nature offers many wonders to the humans. But it depends on the humans, we people. How we take that? Whether we have those eyes to look at the beautiful nature or not. Thank you.